Hello, I'm Luke Dale. I'm an actor and I graduated from drama school in 2015.
Dame Judi Dench has been voted greatest actor of all time by Stage magazine. She beat legendary figures such as Laurence Olivier, John Gielgud and Vanessa Redgrave.
When Judi Dench started treading the boards over 50 years ago, life was very different for an actor. You spent months, sometimes years, out on the road in repertory theatre.
Now what is repertory theatre? Why should you care what it is? Well, prior to the 70s or 80s, repertory theatre was a place where the actors that you know and love could go and train and continue to develop and hone their craft.
Now, for young actors looking for their big break, repertory companies once offered a lifeline, but for many years, the tradition of having a resident theatre company has been dying out.
Actors, older actors, love to talk about the days of rep, you know, when they lived in digs in dingy streets in Sheffield and that sort of thing. Of course, that doesn't happen. This is the closest thing that there is to it now, isn't it?
Actually, I get very grumpy, old man, about the demise of rep theatre, you know, because when I started, I did 5 years in theatres outside London. It was my apprenticeship. Mm. But not just that, for the towns involved, subsidised theatre with great stuff going on. It's a terrible shame.
As an actor in 2017, I would do anything to be able to go somewhere and to continue to develop as an actor. But it turns out things are quite different now.
2 years ago, when I started, it was mandatory to do at least 50 weeks in repertory theatre before you could get your equity ticket. Now they jump in, so it's not their fault, but they don't get the experience.
In just 3 decades, the acting industry has changed completely, and therefore the role of the actor has changed profoundly.
How do young actors make it then? It's much tougher, is it?
I don't know. I mean, I think they have to have access.
Actors have to navigate a career completely differently from how they used to. And I wanted to know whether these changes are detrimental to our acting talent and detrimental possibly to our communities.
So the up and coming British actors at the moment aren't getting enough of the stage experience, in your view?
Unfortunately not. They just do maybe a few stage plays, maybe two, maybe three. And then there's some casting person thinks, oh, you're young and pretty, you know, throw you into a TV series. The most of them are useless. And so we don't really have, unfortunately, some young, great actors today. A few of the old ones are holding the fort. But after they go, we're left in a kind of quagmire of nothingness.
The final nail in the coffin in deciding to make this film was that I was noticing that our great actors were crying out for rep. So I decided to have a look at what rep really is, where it came from, where it went, and ask the ultimate question: are we better off without it?
Well, rep theatre, as we used to call it, is a sign of a town's civilization. Every town in England would have a repertory theatre.
Well, repertory theatre is when you have a permanent company of actors, and while you're performing one play in the evening, you're rehearsing the next one in the daytime.
So you've got this idea of actors belonging to a theatre and being employed for a season, and then the wonderful thing within that is that within that season they would play a variety of roles, often very quickly.
Always producing its own work, and it used to hire actors possibly for a season, even for a year at times, I think. So there was a sense of a sort of company.
You put on a season of plays. So a repertory theatre would put on, let's say, a play a month, or in the extraordinary days, like when I began after leaving Central, I went into weekly rep, so that was 8 plays in 8 weeks.
You go, you read the play on a Monday, it's set by the Tuesday, you know it by Tuesday afternoon, you rehearse the rest of the week and you open the next Monday, by which time you're reading another play, and setting it and everything. So, I mean, it was fantastically strenuous, and really you had to be on the ball to do weekly rep. Sometimes rep was 2 weekly, sometimes.
We did 3 weekly rep, which meant you had 3 weeks to rehearse a play whilst doing another play at night. So if, in my case, what would have been on at night, Undermilk Wood would have been on at night, and during the day we'd have been rehearsing Faust. 8 shows a week, rehearsing a play, obviously very, very little time.
But they were just all over the country. I mean, Dundee and Pitlochry and Sheffield and Norwich and Bristol and York and... I mean, I'm missing out, you know, hundreds of reps, but they were the most glorious places to train in.
So I'm just literally taking it off here, and I can sort of follow you.
This is the Theatre Quarterly, July to September 1972, and it's about, there's an article on Newcastle, and the University Theatre Newcastle, Portrait of a Company.
Lovely.
And if we come over here, you'll see in rehearsals Jim Carter, aged 22 or something like that, rehearsing in a really run-down YMCA gym for Gawain and the Green Knight.
I'd been directed at RADA by a director called Richard Digby Day, who then gave me my first job at Worcester Rep 40 years ago this year.
I started life as an actor and in repertory. Well, I came to running a theatre, or to founding a theatre. I went to live in Hampshire when my children were small, and had this, suddenly, this, I think overnight almost, this passionate view, I shall start a theatre in Basingstoke. In 1974, It was 2 weekly, sometimes 3 weekly. We sometimes managed to squeeze 3 weeks rehearsal, but on the whole it was 2 weekly. And we were seasonal, so we would have a 10-week season in the autumn and a 10-week season in the spring in the main house.
I did some work as a dresser when I was before I went to training at Bromley Little Theatre, which was a rep. Mm. And so I knew it from that point of view.
I got an interview audition at the Birmingham Rep. Now, the Birmingham Rep was considered the best kind of classical rep. It had Schofield, it had Olivier, Albie Finney, Ian Richardson. They'd all been part of the Birmingham Rep in their time.
But I stayed at the Vic from 57 to 61, to and including 61. So I was able, you know, we did Shakespeare after Shakespeare after Shakespeare. I went to Oxford to Frank Hauser. I think I went there 3 times. And I also went to Nottingham, to John Neville's theatre, the Nottingham Playhouse, where there was a repertory.
I went straight from the Central School, knowing that I was going to be a telestar, film star, or something straight away. And the only offer I got was for an on Sea Weekly rep. I thought, oh my God. And then Linda Bellingham and I both left Central and went to Frinton, thinking, well, is this a great start to our career? And then we realised it was. We looked on this board and it said previous members of the company, Julie Christie, Michael Dennison, Vanessa Redgrave. So I thought, oh, that's okay. We're doing all right. They were popular. They were very well attended. And the populace was proud of their repertory company. Yes, and it was nice to see a company, an ensemble, which is what the National Theatre was originally, a group of actors, that they could come and see once a month, doing something else.
But the theatre was very much part of the fabric of the town. They'd feel a sense of kinship and ownership, yeah, of the actors.
They knew the actors. They'd seen them the month before, and now this month they were doing this, and they were doing something totally different to what they had done 4 weeks ago. That was part of the excitement, to see what she was going to do in the next play, or he was going to do in the next play.
They were impressed by the chameleon-like quality of the actor to change so radically.
And so there was a great theatre-going public who would actually go to their rep, you know, it would be a thing that they might do on a Thursday night or a Saturday matinee, or even the Monday night to see all the mistakes.
But you became part of the ethos of the spirit of Birmingham. I was part of what was going on for 3 years, and that gave me a great deal of satisfaction, and hopefully it gave the audience who kind of grew up with me and what I was doing over those 3 years, it gave them a buzz and entertained them.
It's all very well being at your drama school and giving your end of term shows or whatever, but you have to then learn to make the mistakes. You have to then learn what it is to play to different sizes of theatre. You have to somehow sharpen up your act.
I mean, you did a handful of plays at drama school, at a top drama school. Whereas if you'd done a season when Laurence Olivier was young here, you'd have done far more than, in 3 years, you'd have done a lot more than that. You'd have played all ages.
It was about versatility. You know, I was a blonde young actor in his early 20s, but I almost never played blonde young characters in their early 20s. It was a lot of the time about being fitted with wigs and false moustaches and false beards and so on. So it was all about transformation, and that widened your range of expression.
And Anthony Sher's just done Willie Loman was brilliant. But he could only have done that because he's been in the repertory system, whereby he plays Arturo Uy 1 week, Cyrano de Bergerac another month, Willie Loman. So you become like a super actor, closer to the skills of an opera singer or a great ballet dancer.
So I think if you are cast to type for a year, you rest. When you've got to discover a different character, a different body shape, a different mindset, it makes you very alert and hungry and disappointed, and I just think it makes you work very hard.
Once the play was on the very next week, you'd be cast and rehearsing the second play. So the next play is absorbing you, you're rehearsing, and at night you're playing. So you're doubling the impact, not only on the town, on the theatre, on the audience, but on yourself. So the energy that takes and the stamina, you grow, you become an athlete of the theatre.
And you would get some very good habits, you might get some very bad habits, because practically they were putting on shows very, very quickly, and often in a very shortcut way of acting.
It's very much, you're blocked, you know where to go, how to do it, you fix it. And a lot of actors sort of retain that way of working.
A voice teacher that I had, who will be nameless, would just say she called them the woofers. Woof, 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 woof. And really it was just about filling a space and making something work without the proper investigation of the text.
So the disadvantages were that maybe you didn't have enough time to prepare, but that was up to you. Go home and study as much as you could. Don't go to the pub every night with the lads. Go home and be a good boy and read Plutarch or read John Barton's theory about Shakespeare wasn't Bacon.
You're working in rep with actors that you get to know, and that might be good or bad, but you're learning to negotiate, not with just new people all the time, but with people whose work you have to deal with, you have to stay present with. It's a great learning curve to work with people who know your work well. So Judi Dench always gives wonderful stories of that these actors would often stay in the same boarding houses. And over breakfast, the older actors would teach the other actors what went right in the show, what went wrong. So it was an apprenticeship, really.
It's sad when you think that now there are comparatively so few repertory theatres left.
Demise was basically a laziness in theatre managers. A laziness, a spinelessness, a lack of real theatrical ambition. Because even with TV, if your theatre is good, if it's challenging, you could run a theatre successfully for years, whether there's movies on 10 times a day or TV. But in those days, there was little TV, and so the theatre was popular, so even you could get away with junk. Commercial, cheap, shoddy entertainment, farces, simple comedies.
There was the sort of standard view of regional theatre in those days that you had to do four safe plays to one adventurous one, as it were. I mean, that was the sort of ratio that everybody who ran a theatre in those days thought.
They weren't challenging the intellectuals and the intelligent people of the town, and certainly were not challenging the young. So when TV really burgeoned, and when you had more channels, that lazy theatre just was too flaky. It died off. And it died off in the most terrible way, because they thought, oh, we're fighting the television, therefore we become even more cheap. And they wouldn't get actors in of any skill. They get actors from the telly.
People who would be in, you know, series or sitcoms, in probably crap productions, would get big audiences because they knew the name.
And a star and celebrity wasn't going to sign up for a rep season.
So gradually the theatre slides, it kind of rots and it festers, and then in the end you're playing for 30 people a night if you're lucky, and in the end the theatre closes and becomes a bingo hall.
1980, whatever it was, the Thatcherite revolution, the withdrawal of the shrinking of the state, the withdrawal of subsidy for regional theatre, simple as that. It was a financial situation. The impetus was to make everything stand on its own feet, so notions of a 60% subsidy ratio disappeared. Probably mine was the last so-called repertory company to be founded. I think so. I don't think anybody post-1974 started a regional residential company. I don't think so. I've never come across one.
But there are, having said that, there are wonderful reps still around, you know.
Everyone is facing changes.
Rep Theatre is still alive and kicking. I found its spirit thriving in Windsor. So I travelled there to talk to the producer, Paul Taylor Mills, and some of the actors who were in the middle of the weekly rep season.
Changing places. Still.
So we did that this time last year. We did 6 titles. And then I'm delighted to say we're back this year with a further 6 titles. And we're really, really pushing the boundaries. This year we're doing One Man, Two Governors, The Lady Killers, Pygmalion. Really, really ambitious titles, and it terrifies me, and so far it seems to be working, and it puts a lot of pressure on my wonderful team. But my training at Bath Spa was, if you want work to happen, then you make it, and that's rep. You do everything. You will see us all chipping in, and it's an amazing feeling when you open on a Tuesday night here, and you know that you and your company are responsible for everything. And I think it's a great training ground for actors, because they get a sense of, and an understanding and a sensitivity to what it's like to be an ASM, to what it's like to be a stage manager, which can only be helpful for everybody involved in the process. I am in a really, really fortunate position here at Windsor that the adorable Bill Kenwright has made it possible by making sure that our core costs are covered whilst we're here. We're able to nip up to Bill's store in Liverpool or Hampton Court and go, oh, I'll grab that, or it might have been on Scrooge 4 years ago. And we're really fortunate to have Bill's support, because it allows us to produce a production value that is really classy. And we're also, because we're getting it from Bill, we're able to keep the ticket price as low as we dare to.
We've rehearsed an entire play in 6 days, and now we're at the stage today where we're starting to tech. Our first run through was yesterday of the entire thing, and I've never worked like that, having such a limited amount of rehearsals. And it's a meaty play as well, so I think it's been challenging for all of us.
Yeah, it is, but it's so rewarding because of that as well, because the first time when we do the dress run tomorrow will be the first time we really do it with costumes and props and things like that, so it adds the extra element of excitement to it as
it
well
does.
And it forces you to learn your lines and to get into your character and things like that, so it is a challenge, but that makes it more exciting.
It does, yeah. It really, yeah, you have to be on your feet.
Then this happens.
It shows you kind of how tremendous actors are. It forces you to make choices really quickly, whether they're the wrong choice or the right choice, and your rehearsal process is in front of an audience.
I love it. As I say, this is a second time I've been a part of the rep company, and I just love it. I think it's amazing.
And I'm very grateful to be here because, you know, it's quite a tradition, I think, rep, which slowly died off. And for it to
and it's coming back.
It is, yeah. It is. And it's so well supported here, and the audiences are so encouraging.
Absolutely.
And
we've got so many people that come and say, we've booked for all the season.
It's all about the community, and rep theatre allows the community to engage with theatre in a really active way. They get to know the actors, they get to see them doing a variety of different things, and essentially it allows them to be involved. And if you've got a community that is involved through theatre, then it's buoyant and it's got life and it's exciting, and I think that's why it's had the legacy that it's had.
I don't want to stop anybody wanting to be an actor, that's what they want to be, but there is a, it's such a seductive, it's floated in front of you, it's celebrity, it's fame, it's glamour, it's all those things. It can be perceived as such. It isn't, of course, but it can be perceived as such. And people get seduced into it, and they go and do 2 years or 3 years at one more or less reputable drama school. Not necessarily the top drama schools, not the Guildhalls and the Ryders and so on, but or Lowndes. But there are so many drama schools now which are turning into businesses, and they're advertising, and they're taking hundreds, if not, the intake is more than 100 a year. And it worries me enormously because they're getting fees from these people, they're making a business out of it, and there isn't a career for most of them. And I think it's exploitation, and it annoys me. Which I'm sure the teachers are very well intentioned, but there's far too many of them. They're hothousing it. They're being forced into the industry. And where do they go?
I spend a lot of time teaching in various schools and coming into contact with third years who have just been through that whole, been to the showcase, haven't got an agent. Now what? And they didn't have any clue as to how to tackle the industry. They had no clue. They literally come out of that process, they haven't got an agent, their peers have. So they've been through this whole battle for 3 years, fighting for superiority, seniority, tutor favour for 3 years, having invested the same amount of money as anybody else. And at the end of this journey, they haven't got what they came in there for. And just tracking them a little bit after they'd left, and people working in coffee shops, and just went off the radar. It's like, you're incredible. I worked with you on your short film piece. You were great. You haven't got representation, but no one's now guided you into the industry and given you any cat in hell chance of surviving. You could flourish, you just need time to burn.
For young actors today, it is very difficult to develop their craft because you tend to be cast according to how you look. You're physicality, you know, your age, size, racial background, colouring, and personality type.
In the sort of instant celebrity culture that we now reside, most young actors are being asked to play themselves. Ultimately, it's very diminishing and impoverishes the possibility of a long, sustainable career.
I notice in a lot of cases, theatres, and this is not necessarily rep theatres, but they need a name to carry a play.
I think that the rise of the star, the named casting, has come about because commercial theatres and commercial theatre producers have very cleverly stepped in to fill a gap that the perhaps big producing theatres used to fill. And the first thing that an audience member asks when they pick up the phone to buy a ticket is who's in it. And because that's the, what is it about that play that's going to make them feel reassured and want to buy a ticket to it? And actually, if somebody's in it who they've seen on the telly, then that's a really good reassurance. So in a way, named casting is the perfect audience development tool because, for example, there's a show going out at the moment with two former cast members of EastEnders in it. And it's cleaning up everywhere. And probably, I would imagine, a lot of those people have never been to the theatre before. And that's brilliant, because it's bringing in whole new audiences.
Then you think, well, there are a whole lot of actors who don't do film and may not want to because their passion is the theatre. And where do they fit in?
Do you know, basically, I don't know how a young actor today with ambitions for stage, I don't know how you do it. I don't know what journey you have to make. Certainly a different journey to the one I made. I was lucky enough to make. The journey now, you could probably answer that question better than me. I don't know.
Well, what they do, some of them do French, just to keep, you know, them on their toes, just to keep their technique going.
I'm not as despondent as everyone else seems to be about it. We got so much more fringe. When I was at drama school, I can remember there was the Open Space Theatre with the King's Head, and maybe one other. We're talking about the 60s, and then they started building up in the 60s. But now we've got at least 50 fringe theatres in London. And what is great for young actors is they can go and start their own little company. They can put on their own play, and I think that's what's exciting.
So many of those, you know, every fringe theatre is, you know, puts on stunning work, but they're quite often profit share productions, and it's not always financially viable to, as much as you would love to be part of that production, it's not always, you know, advisable to take part in a production like that.
I feel in some respects it's a lot better. I don't think, oh well, those are the days you could do this, because I think things are different now and things have to be different. Now, someone leaving drama school now can go to rep, not many, but they can do that. They can go to television, they can go to radio, they can get a great part in a film, a long-running television series. There are many options. Now, my only slight worry is you can be very highly exposed very early on.
I do think that with television and shows like Britain's Got Talent and everything, that in a lot of cases now, young actors or young people want to make some kind of instant impression, to be instantly recognised. Now, what worries me about that is what happens after that, and what happens to them after that, with no kind of training or no kind of discipline behind them.
You can be very successful early on, or you're exposed to something you're not very good at, you're gone. Oh, okay, right. And people say, yeah, I saw them, no, not great. And you think, right, so you'll have to disappear and do some work somewhere else and come and re-emerge. Now, in repertory theatre, you could know, none of us set out to be bad in repertory theatre, but you weren't exposed to the extent that some actors, young actors, are now. And that's my only worry, is that you might be eaten up, as all of us actors are. You know, you're good in something, you know, you're big news.
And then 4 or 5 years later, you think, oh, whatever happened to that actor or actress? Where have they gone? You know, because they sink.
You're given a leading role, and it's television, and it's media, and it's... So in that sense, it's more difficult to learn. We were allowed to fail, I think, is what I'm saying. We were allowed to make mistakes, because in a sense, there weren't a great many people watching.
I don't think you'll mind me talking about this, but I put Orlando Bloom on in Broadway recently as Romeo, and he was gorgeous man, and he was clever enough to say, look, I better study with you for months before I do this. And he said he knew that everybody in that theatre, the vast majority of members of the audience, were waiting for him to fail, because he hasn't been allowed to fail. As it happened, he didn't fail, but the idea that you're going to try your first Shakespeare role on Broadway with an audience either seeing you as a film star or wanting you to fail is rather sad. So it's not going to develop actors in the same way that a rep system would.
To be able as a young actor to think long term, I think, is a bit tougher now. In rep, we only thought long term, because we thought, well, just keep doing this. No sort of, I want to get to there. I never thought I wanted to get to anywhere. I just wanted to keep working. And I think there might be a pressure now for young actors. Now, you've got to get some film work, because then that makes you that, no, I want to keep, I just want to act. Now, it's the job of the agents, if they're canny enough, to not want to just make money out of a young actor or make a successful, immediate, successful young actor.
So in Britain, London is the source of power. That's where agents are, casting directors are. And it's, you take a risk if you're going to be in something in Hull or Glasgow or whatever, in that the people who need to see you to get you your next job might not be there. to see you, and that might have just gone into a black hole.
We talk to a lot of actors who don't want to go on tour. It's like, how many times do we have to offer this part to somebody before somebody says yes?
A lot of people now wouldn't take a season because they think, oh, then I wouldn't be available for telly. And a lot of agents, I think, would say, do you really want to be in Stratford for a whole year when you, there could be TV or films here?
Yeah, I do want to be there doing that.
There's a lot wouldn't. In fact, our daughter is just leaving drama school, and she went in for an audition recently. And in the audition, they said to her, so what do you want to do? And she said, well, I really like to do classical theatre, but I suppose you hear that all the time. And they said, no, we never hear that. Nobody says that. You know, a lot of people want to do TV and films. Gotta make it, gotta live the dream. Yeah.
You wake up from dreams, actually.
Yeah.
You do wake up from dreams.
Yeah.
So their ambition today is to get onto the TV. And in the TV, they're still acting, and they're doing a series every 2 or 3 weeks. But the difference is that the dynamism of the actor, which enables the actor to touch the inner nerve center of great theatre, to understand and illuminate those curious sentences in Shakespeare, to have the power of suggestion and compulsion and passion is gone. I have felt a loss. I'm looking, where is the Albert Finneys? Where is the O'Tooles? Where are the Nicol Williamses? Where are the Laurence Oliviers? Where are the Paul Schofields? Where are the John, where are they? They ain't there, mate. These people were like, not just good, they were, in a sense, phenomenal, unique. These actors, that's why I made the point in my London Live, do not exist today. They're very good, some of them, but they're limited. And they're not limited by their ambition. Their ambition, they would like to do more, but there's not the opportunity.
I felt I had to hear from the actors themselves, so I sat with some of the young theatre makers of today and asked them how they develop their craft.
My name is Shubham Saraf, and I am an actor who's graduating this year from the Guildhall School of Music and Drama, and I'm very excited.
The majority of what I do, and thankfully, what I love doing, is theatre and fringe theatre. I've been relatively lucky to be in, you know, relatively steady work, you know, a project sort of every couple of months since I graduated.
A lot of work on my own stuff, a lot of writing, creating a one-woman show, some fringe, like pub theatre stuff, and quite a bit of work with like London Film School. Yeah, lots of learning since leaving, I think.
Basically, we're a female-centric theatre company, and we started it because when we were at college, we all went to Royal Welsh. We kind of saw a lot of amazing female actresses leaving and not feeling fulfilled by their careers and not either getting what they wanted or kind of feeling stretched or challenged by the stuff that they were doing. So we kind of looked at it and we just thought it'd be so great if there was a community for people who are so talented, and we could put them, I guess, showcase them, is what we wanted to do.
And we had like a waiting list of girls, and it suddenly was like, wow, you realise how everybody feels the same.
So we are currently working on FC UK'd, which is a piece written by Niall Ransom. And it was the seed of the project started at the Guildhall School in our third year when we were training together. But the play has grown and developed over time, and so we're now performing the premiere long version at the Vault Festival in Waterloo.
Yeah, I think the Vault Festival is particularly a place that's incredible for new writing and new artists. It gives people a platform and it gives people a chance to share their work and do something different and get given an opportunity to perform.
We are a theatre company that champion a collaborative approach to making new work, and we work with new writing mainly.
Yeah, we work with a group of actors, writers and directors, and we give them just 2 weeks to make 4 short plays. So there's kind of a time pressure situation, and then we perform them at the end of that 2 weeks. That's the format that we've used so far over the last year.
When I graduated and didn't have a job, all I wanted was for someone to call me up and be like, we've got this part and we think it'll be great. Do you just want to come and do that? And you just, all you'd have to do is just turn up on the day and just be like, you wanted me and now I can, I'll just do, say some things.
Yeah, people would always say, make your own work. And I'd be like,
that's so tiring.
Yeah.
But actually, I'd say that I get like a huge amount of like creative satisfaction out of it.
I mean, I think it's more rewarding in a way, because it's something you create. You're so attached to it. I mean, getting a play and doing that's great, and you know, it's obviously a fantastic experience. But when you've created it, and you've put blood and sweat into it, and a lot of time, and it's a lot more personal, I think. So I think there's a huge benefit in that.
Given me like a power that you can lose when you leave and maybe don't get on the path you thought you would. So like if you leave and I don't know, you don't get signed or you don't get a big job straight away, you don't get any job straight away, you can quite quickly tell yourself, well, it's because I'm terrible, it's because I've got no skill, it's because I don't look right, I don't sound right. And then when you create something of your own, you're giving yourself that power back. You're deciding that, one, this story needs to be told, and two, I'm the one to tell it. And that's quite exciting.
Having talked to a lot of other people who are, in terms of having made a company, are a little bit beyond us, people have often said to both of us that this period, the second year, is really tricky.
Yeah.
Because the second year is when you need to start getting paid. You can't carry on doing stuff for free. And that's when companies die.
But then we need to work out a way that we can make it profitable, which is difficult when you're making theatre on a small scale and in an industry that's saturated when there's no money flying about. The idea is to this year to get more investment and Arts Council funding, and we're definitely two actors learning to be producers / artistic directors.
Obviously it's not about making money, but there's the very obvious need of that. So I think it's just about being very, very flexible with it, understanding that if you work a 9-to-5 job during the week, you're probably just going to have to work a bit harder, maybe rehearse in the evenings and find people who are passionate about it, as opposed to people who, you know, and rightly so, want money for it. Because everyone would love to be paid for it.
I mean, being a director at the beginning of my career, unless I'm willing to invest in the art itself, a career in directing will never happen. And I think the same is exactly true in acting. You either go make art because you have a need to go make art, or you don't.
Yeah, well, Mischief Theatre are the example of young people working hard. Like when the play that goes wrong, it first opened at the old Red Lion pub. And that's a fantastic fringe venue. It didn't start as a success at all. And I remember playing the techie character in it for a few nights, and you'd sort of go along and the set was all homemade and the costumes were things that they'd found and brought in. And start above a pub theatre, making no money, all really struggling to get by. And 3 years later, be heading off to, you know, Broadway, sort of household comedy names.
I am expecting to work in theatre, and the theatre that I want to work in classical theatre, I want to work. I am expecting and wanting to work at the RSC, at the Globe, at the National. I am expecting and hoping. And I'm also expecting to spend a lot of time on my own searching for things to do, to sort of get by and make a bit of money and live life and stay artistically fulfilled.
You're in drama school 3 years and you're constantly breathing it. You're just breathing that in and out, just theatre and acting and learning so much, and then suddenly it just goes and it's all gone. Mm. And there's no schedule, there's no there's no sort of regular thing in your life.
Yeah.
And I think that's really, I think that's one of the hardest things, is that there's just no plan. There's, you can't plan anything, you can't plan holidays, you can't really do anything. So if you have something like Siberian Nights, when it's every Monday or every other month we do a kind of sort of scratch night vibe or a rehearse reading, and then we put on plays, and you know that that's there, and I think get involved with those kind of communities because there are so many of them.
Play really taught me something that I didn't know as an actor. It would be like the tip that I'd give to actors, which is that I think because there's so many of us and there's so few jobs, we can get into a mindset of like always waiting for somebody to offer you something. I'm writing to people going kind of, give me stuff, give me this job, give me this opportunity. Mm. And very rarely actually offering anything ourselves. And I think often actors can be like, but I don't have anything to offer without someone giving me something.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's true. Yeah. And I think you've, and I think it's really important for actors to recognise that they've got stuff to offer and how attractive it is to say, like, I'm making this or I'm interested in that.
Yeah.
And that is a really good way to forge connections with people, with directors, with companies, with producers, instead of just being like, hi, employ me.
You have to write your own stuff and try it at scratch nights, try it at, you know, open mics and all things like this. It's tough, but you have to make your own work in order to get more work. Work begets work. You just have to keep churning it out and hoping that something will come out if you keep plugging away enough. If you just sit there, like, gone are the days of sitting by the phone waiting for your agent going, okay, come on, where's my part at the National? Come on, it's never gonna happen. You've got to put yourself out there whatever way you can.
There are a lot more younger theatre companies now, and there are a lot more people getting up and writing and directing and taking things to the Fringe or the Vault Festival or things like that, because that's our version of rep. Rep isn't there, so we have to have our own form of creating work.
Does the idea of being in a rep company appeal to you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Why?
God, why not?
That is my dream.
I would absolutely love to be part of a rep theatre company where you just do it, you live and breathe it, and you're in a community and you just do
it's
it
a dream,
the whole
isn't
time.
It?
Yeah, I mean, completely.
I miss it so much. This industry is just, yeah. it needs to come back. It needs to come back in a big way.
Why would people not want to do that? So yeah, that's the answer to my question is yes.
I see. Right. Okay. Want to make that clearer? Or...
Yes.
And of course, the other big one was the Liverpool Everyman, where, you know,
Julie Walters,
Alison Steadman, Pete Postlethwaite, all those people. Jonathan Pryce was probably there.
Did you know that the Liverpool Everyman is, after 25 years, reinstating a repertory theatre company?
I didn't.
That's great.
Yes, you're right, Imelda. It is great. I couldn't believe it either. But after a few months of making this film, the Liverpool Everyman publicly announced that it was going to reinstate a repertory theatre company after 25 years. The Liverpool Everyman was a stalwart powerhouse in repertory theatre in the UK and nurtured some of the best actors we have. I travelled to the Everyman to speak to the people responsible for the idea, Gemma Bodine and Nick Bagnall.
How did the idea of a rep company emerge? What was the crux?
I suppose it sort of haunted me. When you get to be the artistic director of The Everyman and The Playhouse, they both had hugely successful repertory companies. And I suppose most particularly at The Everyman, there was that kind of fantastic time with Julie Walters, the Alan Dosser Company, and amazing actors, Pete Postlethwaite, Anthony Sher, Bill Nye. So you're very aware of that thing called rep and ensemble when you get this job. And no two theatres have sort of done it better. And I would still argue that there's never been a group of people quite like that Everyman company of the 70s. I mean, that's a phenomenal hit rate of talent that Alan Dosser sort of discovered. So it's there and you're thinking about it. But then I think for me, I was beginning to feel that for various reasons, actually economic reasons, more and more, we were either looking at very small casts or looking for co-productions, but some you felt, I really want to tell the stories Liverpool needs, wants to hear, and that isn't always going to be necessarily the story that another co-producer wants to tell. So I began to think about how can we do that more in our own voice.
Just personally, it's really exciting for me because I was getting a little bored in how I made theatre, in the sense of we rehearse for 4 weeks, we do a tech week, and then we have a production week, and then we have a press night. And those 10 days between the tech and the press night felt to me like the show and the company get a little lost and it becomes something else. And I think what this allows us to do is to not have that, in the sense that it's all about the company, it's all about the pieces of work, it's all about the audiences. We're not bowing down to any other artistic directors, we're not having to, it's our stamp on our in our building with our actors.
What do you think the benefits for, firstly, an actor are from doing this kind of work, and after that we'll do the audience? So what are the benefits for an actor?
I think getting three really great parts in five shows is a dream come true. I think you get a chance to flex your muscles in many ways in this season. Young actors, I think it's the perfect training ground. And then we've got a few of those. They're going to get an opportunity to work with stalwart, highly experienced actors. So the gain in that is something else. If it's your first job, I mean, if it was my first job as an actor, I think I'd rather do this than go to drama school. And that's not me putting drama school down. I think I'd learn a lot more.
Jonathan Pryce always talks about when he was, part of the Everyman Company, how they did Winnie the Pooh for a matinee and Coriolanus in the evening. And, it's no surprise, really, that you get a kind of Anthony Sher or a Pete Poss or whoever coming out of that, because how often are you going to get to play Piglet and Coriolanus, in a year?
The actors get to work with Gemma, I and Matt, and we're also in the same building. We're all part of the same company. We're all part of the same team. We can take shortcuts after a while. And Jem tells a great story about Mike Shepherd at Knee High, about being able to just be very blunt, not blunt in a cruel way, but just be very blunt with actors and say, that's not working, let's cut it. And if you've got that relationship with actors, then it feels like you've got more time. For many years now, I've kind of been auditioning a kind of generic young actor, if I'm honest. And that's to do with what drama schools can take. There's usually a well-educated actor with some money. That's not a criticism on that. That's absolutely vital, as well as the people who can't afford to go to drama school. So what we did here was we opened up the auditions to the city, to actors in the city. And it's quite incredible because we literally have found a couple of truly extraordinary young actors that wouldn't be able to go to drama school. So it feels like it's a political statement as well, which is great.
Where do you expect or hope the company to be after the 6 months?
We want it to be ongoing. I mean, it's absolutely part of at least a five-year plan for these theatres.
I think the next 5 years are going to be really, really interesting. It is on the pulse and people are talking about it. Industry leading figures such as Liverpool are seeing the value of having a rep company, and the National are talking about evolving into that model too, and I think it'll be really interesting to see over the next 5 years what happens.
As long as there's a story to be told, and as long as there is a space to tell it in and somebody to come and hear the story, theatre is going to be all right. And that's what the repertory theatres did so brilliantly. They provided for each town something that changed each week or each fortnight, and brought people together. And they were so crowded, all the theatres, because people would just go on their favourite night and go and see their favourite people.
The Birmingham Rep just gave me the biggest transfusion of theatrical blood that I needed to carry me through the life of a theatrical career.
As long as there are some of those reps going, and they keep going, there's a light, a little flame that we can nurture and hope that it, sometime in the future, will come back to being a bonfire.